All right, I've cranked the volume up. It should be loud enough. This should be loud enough. Okay, very great. Have a lot to say here. So we might as well just like jump right in and get to it. Did you know that the intelligence, what we call human intelligence, is really fake intelligence? It's just as fake as like a parrot saying something like the parrot will say, reboot, reboot. Like you hear someone techie teaches the parrot to reboot your computer. Reboot, reboot. computer crash, reboot, reboot, or something. The parrot has no idea what that means at all, really. Parrot can f give fake intelligence like they know something. The intelligence that we are used to calling intelligence is fake intelligence. It's fake. It's absolutely fake. It's mimicking the same way a parrot will mimic what we say. The intellect that we use to get good grades in school, to get good jobs and all of that, it's fake intelligence. It's not true intelligence at all. It comes from the ego. True intelligence comes from what's called the Holy Spirit, the voice within, the voice of clarity, the voice of reason within us that God placed there as we engage in this hypothetical scenario with hypothetical intelligence, hypothetical understanding. It's not true understanding at all. God made sure, placed within us the voice of reason. And what we have to do in our lives is spend time listening to the voice of reason and remember and becoming acquainted and familiar and learning true intelligence. Otherwise, we'll just fake it. We'll try to fake it, and that won't work. John 14, 1 through 7. When Jesus was about to leave, they asked him, "Where are you going?" And he said, "In my Father's kingdom, there are many mansions or many dwelling places. In my Father's mansion, there are many dwelling places. If it weren't so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you, and so that I'm go and come back and take you there, so where I am, you will dwell also." And Thomas said, "Well, how do we know how we get there?" He says, "No, you will know the way. You will know the way." And then he said, "Well, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except for me," etc. Saying that. Now, that means true intelligence is the way. When Jesus is talking in that way, he's talking from the standpoint of true intelligence. That is the way. I am the way. True intelligence is the way. And true intelligence knows how to ascend, knows how to shift dimensions, knows how to do all that easy, simple, basic. Whereas fake intelligence doesn't know. So, what I recall before I came into this world, I recall everybody in this world screaming, "We're help, help, we're trapped, we're trapped, we're trapped, we're trapped, we're trapped." And now I finally see today, I finally saw what they're talking about. Fake intelligence is trapped. When you spend all your time with fake intelligence, and then it comes time to leave a planet, as planets do go through cosmic catastrophes on a fairly cyclical basis, you can't, you don't know how to leave, because fake intelligence doesn't have a clue, doesn't have a clue how to do it, doesn't have a clue. And so you feel like you're trapped. You keep turning to fake intelligence, and fake intelligence can't tell you how to do it. Whereas true intelligence is say, "Of course, it's easy. This is all a dream." You simply operate from a level of choice, level of perception and choice. Very simple. And yet people say, "What are you talking about? I have no fake." Those who listen to fake intelligence don't have a clue. So, Jesus also said, from what I understand, a very renowned scholar of the original Aramaic, etc. When Jesus gave the advice to what we should do, he said, "You should consider my words like a cow chews its cud." In other words, constantly. In other words, you're supposed to consider true intelligence the way a cow chews its cud, constantly. And that's exactly what I've done my whole life, especially the last 35 years, most very intensely. It's constantly trying to listen to true intelligence and get used to it and get familiar with it, so I can speak the language. Now, imagine if you wanted to learn like a language like German, and would you do it in 10 days, a year? How good would you be in 10 years? What if you did it for like 3, 4 decades, and every day you polished it and got better and better and better? Well, in 4 decades, you might very well speak German better than hardly any, almost all Germans. You would probably speak incredibly great German. So you can learn. Learning, paying attention to true intelligence, it is possible. I've done it. I'm very comfortable and familiar with true intelligence now. and I'm able to look in that in the way that it looks and see in the way that it sees, some more or less, sometimes more, sometimes a little less, because just constant work at it. Now, if watching television was the way to do this, then I must be the stupidest person in the world. Either that or watching the television is not the way to do it. If it is, again, I have to be the stupidest, dumbest person on the planet, bar none. And I don't think that's anyone can make that case. So you don't learn learn true intelligence. You don't become familiar with it by watching television. Yeah, or movies or any of that kind of stuff. No way. No way. Even by reading books, most magazines, the social things people do, everything that people do, it doesn't acquaint them with true intelligence at all. Zero, zippo. That's why they feel trapped. So of course they feel trapped. They say, we don't know how to leave. I came here in this world trying to tell them, people, you have to spend your life getting acquainted with true intelligence, and then you will know the way. It'll be simple, be easy. And didn't do it. People didn't do it. Didn't do it. They kept trying to say, oh yeah, we're smart enough. We get it. We get it. We're smart. It's not about smart. What they're really saying is, hey, we can fake it. We've been faking it so long. We can fake this too. But at some point, faking it's not good enough. The intellect you use to get grades again in school, please the teacher, that's fake intelligence. It's nothing to do with true intelligence. That's why I quit school, paying any attention pretty much seventh grade. I said, I can't do this anymore. This is absolutely ridiculous. There's nothing has nothing to do with intelligence, true intelligence, nothing to do with it. School has absolutely zero to do with true intelligence. Nothing, nada. So all these smart people, you may think all these smart people in the world, they're so smart, they went to great universities, got all these great degrees. That doesn't mean anything as far as true intelligence goes. Nothing, zero. Zero. If you spend one day focusing on true intelligence, you'll be wiser than someone who has all the degrees in the world if they haven't done that one day. Just like that. Just spend one day at it, and then you'll be wiser than those and everyone who has not spent that day. Everyone. Doesn't matter if they're like the supposedly the smartest scientist in the world. You'll be wiser and smarter, actually smarter than they are. Now, if you do it every day without fail, and the year after year after year after year, eventually you're going to be have a pretty good notion of what's going on. You're going to have a pretty good comfort zone there, which is what's necessary. So it's not a joke when people come into this world and say, hey, you have to take the spiritual path. It means you have to get used to real intelligence. There's no way around it. No way around it. And what happens, what I've seen, is people just say, they keep thinking. They keep thinking that it's like a classroom situation, like there's a teacher and they're like students, and they gotta use their intellect to get an A in the classroom. It's not that way at all. No, it's not that way at all. But that's the problem. There's so many fake intelligence people in the world now who have all these college degrees and gone through all this schooling. They think they're smart. It's all fake intelligence. And they just think, oh, okay, I've gotten all these A's, so many A's in this class. All I have to do now is use this fake intelligence. I can fake my way to another A. Well, can you fake yourself off the planet? Can you fake yourself into shifting dimensions? Can you fake yourself into the death-free realm? Can you fake all that? See, that's the question. So it's not about getting an A in any classroom. It's about actually getting the work done, is getting familiarity. And what I see is people just want to learn the verbiage or something like a classroom, like reading a book. Okay, I learned the verbiage, and I can parrot that back. Doesn't mean anything. You have to be able to see it. You have to be able to see it for yourself. You have to be able to work with this in your own mind and listen and the. There's a reason what places itself. It's in your mind, and it will place ideas and concepts and says, look at it this way, look at it this way, look at it this way. And you have to actually work at it. Work at it, work at it, work at it. It's the only way. Jesus said that's the only way. No one comes to the Father except in that way. And then true intelligence will tell you that you have to, the remedy is choice. You have to choose. Choice is not a process. And what you choose to change perception. That's how you do it. That's how you do it. You have to choose change perception. I'm sorry, you have to choose a new perception. That is the right way to say it. You must choose a new perception. Exchange perceptions, as it were. Exchange perceptions. Exchange the perception we have now, which is really nothing more than the attempt to make death real, and exchange it for the vision, the perception, which is a vision of Christ. Vision of oneness. Vision of oneness. The vision of oneness solves the continuity problem. So the way that I talk is from the standpoint of true intelligence. Most of the time. Most of the time. Sometimes I give a little break and chat about some other stuff. But always come back to true intelligence. Once you learn it to speak this way, you can speak this way. I can speak this way constantly. But nobody wants to, you know, listen. Hardly anyone wants to listen to true intelligence. They say, oh, no, why do we need that? Well, we can fake it. Well, again, try faking yourself into shifting dimensions. So that's why people are getting worried. And what happens is they're frantically clinging to those who are better fakers than they are, the big fakers, the most expert fakers, I mean, of fake intelligence. They're embracing them, like desperately, as if that's where their safety is. That's where their safety is. Now, not to pick on anyone, but for illustrative purposes, because this is the way the situation is right now. The president of the United States, for instance, he was. When he first campaigned in, what was it, 2008, and he was coming on strong, like, and people are saying, my God, this is the most intelligent person in the world. It's incredible. And he's the Messiah. He's the one. He's going to change the world, everything. And it was just all this incredible hype. And I said, well, you know, this is very difficult, but I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. And I'll listen to a debate. I'll listen to his mind. I'll observe his mind, and I'll see what's what. So I gave him 10 minutes, and in 10 minutes, it was completely obvious, utterly completely obvious that he's a complete phony, fraud, fake intelligence mentality, totally fake intelligence. But he's really good at it. He's very good at it. You see, he's a very good faker. He's learned how to fake intelligence very, very cleverly. So that's why he's president. That's why he's in the position he is. And that's why people are adoring him so much and are embracing him and are going towards him like the Messiah, because they think that their safety lies in just being better fakes. And he's going to train them how to be better fakes. And, of course, fake intelligence also is a bully, very bad bully. It bullies, tries to bully through intelligence to show how smart it is and how superior it is. It's so insecure, it tries to show how superior it is. Bully. And so what we're getting is all this wave after wave of bullying coming. The people who are aligning with this fake intelligence are trying to bully those who have true intelligence. They're trying to push them around. They're trying to boss them around. They're trying to assign roles to them. And it's getting very, very, very severe and will become way more severe. So that's why those people of true intelligence will leave the planet. They will leave the planet. They'll sidestep this. They're not, for me, I'm not going to allow myself to be pushed around in this world, be bullied, no way. I'll just use my true intelligence to sidestep the entire thing. And then whether I come back or not, I don't know. When things cool down, maybe things will cool down here, but there'll also be like an underground railway to help people sidestep this bullying. There's extreme bullying coming, extreme bossing. It's already happened. It's already coming. People get their marching orders through the television and popular media, all the popular media and news and entertainment industry. And the orders are from on high coming down, say, start bullying, start pushing those around who don't honor your fake intelligence, who don't have the right obedience and to this fake intelligence, who are not following the one, you know, the one who's supposed to lead everyone to the happy salvation, happy world, utopia. Start bossing them around, start pushing them around, start asserting your authority over them. And that's what's happened. That's what's happened. That's what I was alluding to, saying, hey, things are going to get very severe. It's happening. And so for me, just said, hey, I'm not sticking around. True intelligence, it doesn't insist that it get bullied or pushed around or even hang out in that kind of situation. No, they say, forget it. Forget it. I'll sidestep this situation here. Sidestep the bullies. The bullies will go looking for him. They can't find him. They can't find you. The best, don't confront bullies. It's useless. It's a useless thing. They'll feel that you're attacking them because they think that you're, by pointing out their intelligence, they're using as fake. They think you're attacking them, trying to demean them, being derogatory towards them. And so the best thing to do is don't confront bullies. Just sidestep so the bullies don't even never find you. They never even find you. That's the way to do it. That's true intelligence will do it that way. So there's a mouthful to get started. To get started on. Encapsulating a lot of issues there. It's not easy to get used to true intelligence. It takes work. It takes effort. It takes effort. It takes quiet listening. It takes very patient listening. It takes tremendous determination and perseverance to determine between the fake and the true, the fake and the true, the fake and the true. Now, how do we get off the planet? How do we sidestep the bullies, as it were? Because this bullying is going to be planetary. They have all the technology to boss everybody around, push everybody around, try to prove everyone how and smart they are, you know, how smart they are, how smart fake intelligence is. And of course, if you just brush it off like that nonsense, they'll think that you're crazy and that you're being disrespectful, being derogatory, and all these other terms they use to demonize those who recognize that it's fake intelligence. Look what they did to Jesus, for instance. They didn't like his intelligence at all. Because he wouldn't bow to fake intelligence. Having to inform people truly. So, how do we shift dimensions? How do we ascend? How do we sidestep the bullying? And it's very simple. We have to work at, do the exercises. There are exercises that need to be done. It's called rehearsal. You rehearse. In hypothetical land, the way you rehearse hypothetically, what would it be like if I could get off this planet? Or how would I be able to do that? Let's rehearse that. It's done through choice. It's done through choosing. Level of choice. What we don't realize is that the power of choice is within us. And we can choose a different hypothetical. We really can. We can also choose a different idea in reality as far as the idea we want to entertain. We're entertaining the idea of wanting to be prime creator. We can choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. We have the power of choice. We were created with the power of choice, and we still have it. It's still within us. Yet fake intelligence tells us that we don't have it, that it's the only power we have is the power of process. So they say the only way to get off the planet is through a power of process. They're trying to make rockets and all this kind of nonsense. No, it's the power of choice. Choice is based in time. Choice is right now. The effects of choice begin right now. There's no gap between choice and the effects of choice. So there's no real process. Process is an illusion. No such thing as process. It's hypothetical. Choice is the power that we have. We choose to do so. We choose to do so. And we choose to choose a new perception. Perception is our choice. We're choosing our perception right now, choosing the thingness, to see thingness, the way we're perceiving right now, sensory perception. We're choosing that. We can just as easily choose a different perception that's not sensory perception, that doesn't require the brain, doesn't require the body, doesn't require the brain, doesn't require thinking, doesn't require all this fake intelligence at all. Doesn't require it at all. Perception is a choice. So, the way to do it is there's exercises that originate within the that are set in the context of choice and perception. Choice and perception. That should be the mantra. Choice and perception. Choice and perception. And you begin working on these exercises, and you begin to be able to make affirmations. Affirmations that are like waking up your remembrance of your power of choice. The power of choice. You need to awaken to that. We're asleep to it, as it were. We're asleep to it. It's like someone in a bed dreaming and there's a fire in the house and they can't seem to wake up and remember that they can run out of the house. So they keep tossing and turning, trying to find the answer to dream. So what do you do under those circumstances? Well, in the dream, you have to dream a dream of rehearsal. So like, let's start dreaming a dream of getting out of bed and walking, even though we're still sleeping. And then at some point, we'll be able to easily awaken and say, oh yeah, all I have to do is get out of bed and run outside and I'll be okay. So as long as we're still deluded, as it were, in dreaming and unaware of the power of choice, what we need to do is start rehearsing the power of choice. We have to start like dreaming, what if we had the power of choice kind of thing, even though we're not quite yet able to wake up and actually assert the power of choice. The way to eventually assert the power of choice is to rehearse, as if, rehearse, begin to rehearse. That's what the exercises need to be done. Those exercises have to be done. It's a rehearsal process. Again, if you're in a house and you're in a bed and you're sleeping and you're dreaming and there's a fire in the house and it's getting closer and closer, you feel the heat, you're tossing and turning, but you're so deeply immersed in this dream you're having, you forget all about the fact that you can jump out of bed and run outside. So what do you do? Someone has to come into the dream and say, let's dream a slightly different dream, the one we're dreaming right now. Let's dream a dream of jumping out of bed and going outside. Let's dream that and keep dreaming it and keep practicing that in the dream. And then at some point, you'll say, hey, I'm dreaming. I need to wake up. And you wake up and say, oh, I can run outside easy. It provides continuity. It's the way to work within dreams to provide continuity. This is the secret. This is the secret of really salvation. Secret of salvation is working within dreams, substituting other dreams that solve the continuity problem. That is how it's done. So there are exercises that have to be done if you want to truly ascend, if you truly want to sidestep the bullying that's going to become out of control on this planet. Out of control. The control freaks are going to be in control. And sidestepping is easy. Easy if you know how. If you, just like when you wake up from a dream and the house is burning down, jump out of bed, run outside. How difficult is that? Easy. Piece of cake. You don't even think about it. You just do it. Boom. But when you're dreaming, you can't move your body, right? Because you're not awake. So it gets hotter and hotter and hotter. And you say, there's something terrible going on. I feel trapped. And you're really worried. And you're not able to wake up. Because you're still locked into this. You're so frantic in your dream. You're searching for answers within the dream instead of waking up. So doing the exercises is super important. I've been introducing them the last several videos. And today I was working on them even more. Every day I work on them and come up with more and more and more and more clarity on how to do it. So at some point soon I'll be able to actually help people out directly with these exercises and show people how to do it. That's what's necessary. It's absolutely necessary now to do that. Conceptualization isn't enough right now. It's not. Because that's way too easily can be fake intelligence can just grab a hold of that and you can just spin your wheels. Whereas the exercises, it blows fake intelligence out of the water. Fake intelligence can't go with it. Because if fake intelligence says, this is crazy. I don't understand this at all. This is nuts. And can't do it. It can't do the exercises. Not really. But true intelligence can do the exercises. See, this tree is not a tree. This tree has never been a tree. This tree will never be a tree. At no time is this tree ever a tree. And yet this road is not a road. It has never been a road. At no time is this road ever a road. And you can say stuff like, my only function here is salvation. And seeing a world, the world that I really want, is my salvation. My function here is to see a world I really want. My function is to see a world I really want. Behind this world is a world I really want. Behind this tree is a tree I really want. Behind this road is a road I really want. Behind this earth is an earth I really want. Behind this universe is a universe I really want. Salvation is my only function here. You can string all these various exercises. You can come up with them yourself if you're fluent, which is what I can do. I can actually put together stuff and come up with exercises like that. A Course in Miracles gave out 365 exercises, and what I do is I kind of blend them together and come up with something that's very fresh, very useful right now. very, very powerful, helpful exercises. I don't follow them verbatim, as it were. But what I do is I pray to the Holy Spirit to what's useful. Give me a useful exercise. And then it puts the answer into my mind, and I'm aware of an exercise and a way to do it. Salvation is my only function here. That is verbatim. But then you can add that to other stuff. Anyway, I'm getting more and more adept at this. And at some point, I'll be able to help others directly with exercises, doing the exercise, how to start doing them. And once you learn how to do it, you can just start doing it all the time. It's not that difficult. It's just that fake intelligence won't help you. You can't turn fake intelligence in these exercises. You cannot. It doesn't have a clue what you're doing. It really does not. So you have to be able to trust true intelligence in order to do these exercises. You have to say, yeah, this is based on true intelligence. This is right. This is right. You can say, seeing a world I really want is my only function here. Seeing a world that I really want is my only function here. Behind this world is a world that I really want. Salvation is my only function here. This tree is not a tree. It is not showing me this tree is showing me the function of trying to make death real. But I don't want that. Behind this tree is a world that I really want. And that is my only function here. Behind this tree is a world I really want. This tree is showing me the function of trying to make death real. But my only function here is salvation. And behind this tree is a world that I really want. And seeing a world that I really want is my salvation. And you can work these various threads together. And so it's a creative thing. It's not a rote thing like a parrot. You're not being a parrot. Don't be a parrot. If you start becoming like a parrot, you got to stop and say, well, wait a minute. This isn't working. It has to grab you. It has to grab you. You have to feel it. And you have to say, hey, this is resonating. This is resonating. This is really resonating. Okay. Then you know you got it. Now, after a while, maybe you feel bored. You know, it's kind of flattened out for you. Okay. Then you have to ask the Holy Spirit for a fresh approach, and it'll give you a fresh approach. And then you just keep doing that. If you're a musician, you know when you're playing and you've been doing some riff and everything, at first it feels really fresh and after a while it feels stale, right? And then you've got to get into some other riff or something, right? Some other variation that keeps it fresh. It's like that. Using your musicianship to keep these exercises fresh. That's what I do. And it works. And so you just make slight alterations, introduce little different elements, turn it this way, turn it that way, and keep it fresh, keep it fresh, keep it fresh for yourself. Keep it fresh. And sometimes eventually you kind of get tired, you'll hit a flat spot, and then you can go back on something. Just salvation is my only function here. Something that's just basic, because you'll get a little tired. Salvation is my only function here. Salvation is my only function here. I mean, I don't two function, I only have one function. Salvation is my only function here. They say, perceiving this tree only reminds me of death. But this tree is not a tree, it's never been a tree, never will be a tree. Behind this tree is the function that I truly want. Beyond this tree is the function that I truly want. Beyond this, anything you see, this car is the function that I truly want. Beyond this road is the function I truly want. Beyond this building is the function that I truly want. I can see, I'm perceiving this wall, but this wall is not my function here. So perceiving this wall is not my function here. So let's say you're looking at a wall. Perceiving this wall is not my function here. Salvation is my own function here. And beyond this wall is a world that I really want to see, that I really want to perceive. Okay, beyond this wall is a world that I really want to perceive. Beyond this wall is a world that shows me my function is salvation here. Do these kinds of things. My only function is salvation, but perceiving this wall is not showing me my function here, my only function here. But beyond this wall is a world that I really want to see, what I really want to see. Beyond this wall is what I really want to see. You can say it that way too. It's up to you. You know, you have to do it yourself. You have to come up with the words that feel right for you. It is a do-it-yourself kind of thing. But you can get some, just like a physical trainer, they can't exercise for you, but they can show you the exercises and encourage you. But you're not going to get in shape if you don't do the exercises. You're not going to get in shape watching the physical trainer work out. That's impossible. That's like watching television and thinking you're going to gain true intelligence. No, you're not. So each one has to do the exercise, and of course everyone will do it in a slightly different way. There's not some dogma here we're teaching. There's no dogma here at all. There are certain powerful exercises that you know, the general framework is there. And there's some that are pretty basic and that are so powerful that this wall is not a wall. This wall is never been a wall. This wall will never be a wall. At no time is this wall ever a wall. Perceiving this wall only shows me death. But beyond this wall, I can perceive a world that shows me life. That shows me, that reminds me of life. Beyond this wall, I see a world that reminds me of life. I will see a world that reminds me of life. Beyond appearances, beyond concepts, beyond images, beyond labels, beyond things. See, this thing is not a thing. This whatever, this tree is not a tree. This is speaking from perceptual level. We're rehearsing going beyond seeing trees as trees, okay? That's all it is. We're rehearsing going beyond seeing trees as trees. And when we go beyond that, what we see is one life. One life, just one life. It's not the life of a tree, the life of a road, the life of a wall. No, one life. Just one life. That's what we're going to see. One life. Call it God, call it life. It's actually a dream of life. Because we're dreaming a happy dream, a waking dream, before we finally set all hypotheticals down altogether. But we see a dream of one life. We don't see the life of a tree, the life of the dirt, the life of the road, the life of the wall, the life of the house, the life of the sky, the life of the sun. We don't see those anymore. We see just one life. Vision of oneness, vision of one life. So perceptually, to rehearse this, we need to take each thing we see that we think has a separate life, a separate thingness, and say, this thing is not what I see it as. It is not what I see it as. It's never been what I see it as, and never will be what I see it as. And then by knocking that out, but then you say, beyond this is a vision that shows me what I really want to see, which is one life, the one life. And true intelligence knows that doing these exercises is the way. Whereas fake intelligence will keep saying, no, you're smart enough, you don't have to do those exercises. That's only for the dumb people. You should be smart enough to figure it out. What fake intelligence is really saying is that it doesn't want to get left behind. It doesn't want to be exposed as the complete fake that it is. And when you start doing these exercises, you start feeling effects. You start realizing, hey, this is it. This is it. This is the key. I'm opening the door. Fake intelligence then has been exposed. It's been exposed because it tells you, no, this won't work. This is bogus. There's nothing, but this is crazy. It turns out to be the opposite is the case. And then you know, fake intelligence is totally fake. And it doesn't want you to see that. So it doesn't want you to do these exercises. It does not. And we'll fight you tooth and nail. But you know what? Right now, you've got the leverage to push back and say, no, I'm doing these. I'm doing these no matter what. I don't care what you say. I don't care how stupid you think I'm doing them. Because you don't want to be pushed around in this world, do you? You don't want to be bullied. You don't want to be bossed. You don't want to be put in roles that are assigned to you. You don't want to be re-educated. You don't want to bow down to fake intelligence. You don't want to live in some nightmare techno-fascist world. Forget. So you say, no, I'm doing these exercises. Fake intelligence, I'm not listening to what you say anymore. So that's how it goes. That's what's going on. That's what's going on now. This is the new gear. This is the shift that we are undertaking right now. And this shift literally will give us the power of choice. We will remember the power of choice. And the power of choice simply says, oh, I want to sidestep this world now. These are the end times, catastrophic times are coming, not just societal-wise, but geophysically at some point, too. Absolutely. There are cosmic changes going to happen to the Earth. Earth is going to be remodeled. So, but easy. You just choose to sidestep. You just choose, I'm going to go to another place. And your power of choice simply takes you there. It takes you there. And you can take a leisurely stroll there. You don't have to instantly go there. No, I don't. That, because that's a continuity issue right there. So you can say, okay, I understand continuity issues. So we're going to take a nice journey, beautiful journey to another place and hang out there for a while. It's very simple. Completely simple, actually. Once you have the power of choice, once you've awoken to the power of choice, then you're not trapped. You are not trapped. You're not trapped anywhere. As long as we're dreaming, we're going to feel trapped. So how do we awaken to the power of choice? Through rehearsing this awakening and asserting our right. Asserting our right, because perception keeps us bound. You see, fake intelligence tells us that this perception was given to us by God. The perception of things was given us by God. It's the only perception there is. And if we throw it away, if we get rid of it, we won't have any perception at all. We'll be annihilated. No perception. That's a total lie. It's a total lie. Sensory perception is like wearing blinders. It's like a blindfold. It's not the only perception there is. It, far from it. It's like the lowest perception there is. It's terrible. It's completely limited. The idea that if you throw sensory perception away, you'll have no perception is ludicrous. Now, you don't want to harm sensory perception. It has its rudimentary function. Sure, nothing wrong with that. But you're not limited to sensory perception. You don't become informed about the power of choice through sensory perception at all. Not at all. And the ego, fake intelligence, tells you, no, this God gave this to you, so you can't do nothing else. This is it. Nonsense. We gave ourselves this. We bound ourselves to this blindness. Hypothetically, what if reality were destroyed? What if we'd have to try to make death real and then survive it? And so we're focused on all these things that can die, all these thingness, and we don't see the other hypothetical. What if we didn't need hypotheticals that would show us one life? Just one life. Just one life. Not the life of trees, everything, mountains, etc. Just one life. Living it all. Just one life. Not many. Just one. See, and we can literally perceive that. There is a perception to perceive, but not sensory, physical sensory perception. Can't perceive that. Scientific instruments cannot perceive that. And there's only one life. That's a hypothetical. So if you don't want to perceive it, you won't see it. If you, it's because it's a hypothetical. So of course the scientists can't find this. How can they find it? As they do understand, some quantum physicists understand, is your the attitude of the observer affects at the quantum level affects what you're observing, of course, because this is all hypothetical. Perception is hypothetical. Existence, matter, form, energy is hypothetical. So of course your hypotheticalness affects what you're going to perceive at the quantum level, and even at this level, it all holds true. So if you don't want to perceive one life, you won't find it. You won't find it. You won't be able to perceive it. You won't find it. So the scientists say, we haven't found this. We haven't. So it must not be there. It's nonsense. That's fake intelligence again. Fake intelligence. Some scientists have some true intelligence, that the quantum, some of the quantum physicists, some of those who are going at it from that direction, they may have some true intelligence working for them. Some, I don't know how much, and could be there's not a whole lot. I don't know, but most scientists only have fake intelligence going for them. Just fake. They're just real good fakers, very good fakers. Thinking, hey, look, we're discovering. No, they're not discovering the power of choice at all. What true intelligence discovers and tells you about is the power of choice. That's what true intelligence is trying to wake you up to, is the power of choice. Not the meaning the power of what you how you perceive. The choice of what to perceive and how to perceive and what to perceive. Do you perceive many, many lives or one life? That's a choice, entirely a choice, 100% a choice. That's the whole issue. What are you choosing to perceive? Because what you choose to perceive either solves a continuity problem or completely fails to solve it. Okay, if you see many lives here, that doesn't solve the continuity problem at all. If you see one life, that solves a continuity problem. And it's entirely up to each one of us what we perceive. It's a choice. We're simply choosing. There's no process involved at all. None. no process involved. So when we say this tree is not a tree, that's like a choice statement. You're saying I'm choosing to not see this tree as a tree. It's never been a tree, it never will be a tree. And then you're opening the door to seeing it differently, right? And you're seeing, instead of a tree, you're seeing the one life living through that tree and living through everything else. And that solves a continuity problem. So that, and it also solves the problem of if we need to shift dimensions or go somewhere else, it solves that problem too. And it's highly likely we will need to. Highly likely we will need to. And many will want to go, but they'll turn to fake intelligence and, you know, like Jesus said, I never knew you or something. It's meaning the true intelligence will say, you never listened to me. You never listened to me. You never. I was there the whole time and you never listened to me. So how in the world are you going to escape all this bullying and problems? Because you don't know the way, which is choice. You just choose to it. Choose to do so. And people here are saying, no, fake intelligence tells you, no, there's process. You got to go. It's a process. You have to go. You have to achieve it through process. See, that's a lie. That's a lie of fake intelligence, a lie of ego. You attain it through choice. It's just a choice, a simple choice of what do I choose to see? The many are the one. Which? The many are the one. Which? What do you choose to see? Now, the one is living through these many forms, as it were, in a dream, dream-wise. But there's only one life. There's only one life living through the many forms. They're not many lives connected. No, that's fake intelligence saying that. There's no connectivity of many different forms and lives being connected or something into one large aggregate or something. No. Again, all of form and energy is simply a dream. It's a hypothetical scenario. So there's no reality to any of this whatsoever. But we need, in order to recognize we've been dreaming and we never left reality, we need to have a dream that has some continuity with reality. In other words, it's very similar. So seeing the one life through all forms, just one life, just oneness, vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, provides that continuity we need. Okay, and fake intelligence is so busy connecting everybody. You know, that's all it's doing. And it's just an utter waste of time. Utter waste of time. So some people call the smartphones, they call them dumb phones. Because they're giving this idea, this notion that, hey, all we need to do is people connect, like send a text to someone like, hey, I'm smart. That's what I just did. I sent a text like that. Wow, I'm really smart. So all these people are getting a fake idea of what is intelligence. Fake intelligence. Machine language, that's all fake intelligence. All this high-tech stuff is totally fake intelligence. They're even trying to develop artificial intelligence. Well, it already is artificial. Why develop artificial intelligence? All this stuff in the world is already artificial intelligence. It's already fake intelligence. It just wants to try and extend itself in some way. So it's like some even more artificial intelligence or something to try and prove how smart we are. It's all fake intelligence. It has nothing to do with the power of choice. Nothing to do. It leads you away from it. It leads you, keeps you bound to process. The exercises bypass process. Just says this, no time needed. This tree is not a tree. Where's their process in that? Where's their time? There's no time or process involved in that statement. It's a direct statement right now. This tree is not a tree. Feel how that feels. You're not asking a question of fake intelligence like, is this tree a tree? No. You're not. You're telling yourself, this tree is not a tree. Meaning, I am finished with perceiving the tree as a tree. That's what it really means. But the shorthand way is, this tree is not a tree. And your intelligence understands this, that you're taking a stand saying, I'm no longer going to perceive separate lives, many lives here. No, I'm going to see the one life. So this tree is not a tree. This tree has never been a tree. This tree will never be a tree. And this, at no time is this tree ever a tree. Never, never, never. This tree is not a tree. It's just this basic format. It is basically all we need with this variations on it. You can introduce variations, but it's good to stick with the bread and butter, you know, a lot of time. If you have a meal, you can't just have a meal with just a little bit of relish. Just eat a little bit of relish. You want to eat the main course. So, this tree is not a tree. This screen is not a screen. This screen is not a screen. It is not a screen. This person is not a person. These people are not people. These people are not these people. Meaning, I'm no longer going to perceive the many. I'm going to perceive the one. This tree is not a tree. These trees are not trees. This vegetation is not vegetation. This landscape is not this landscape. These buildings are not these buildings. This chair is not this chair. This table is not this table. This camera is not this camera. This computer is not this computer. These lights are not these lights. This plant is not this plant. This concrete is not this concrete. These stones are not these stones. This rain is not this rain. This snow is not this snow. This weather is not this weather. This cold is not this cold. This day is not this day. This year is not this year. This century is not this century. This hour is not this hour. This minute is not this minute. This second is not this second. Even this moment is not this moment. Okay, because the statement is prior to any moments at all. Because you're saying choice is prior to any moments. It doesn't require moments. It's primary. Choice is primary. God, the prime creator, created us as choosers to choose our experiencing. So choice is the most primary. It is the power that we have. So this moment is not this moment. It has never been this moment. It never will be this moment. At no moment is this moment ever this moment. Meaning, I choose. I'm going to use the power of choice to perceive the one life. The one moment through all moments, as it were, the one life. This day is not this day. This day is not this day. This day is not this day. It has never been this day, never will be this day, and no time is this day ever this day. Beyond this day is what I really want to see. Beyond this day is the vision of oneness, the vision of one life, which is my only function here, is to see that, to see the vision of one life is my only function here. To see the vision of one life is my only function here. Okay, you can try that. To see the vision of one life is my only function here. I have no other function here. I have no other function here. I have no other function here. You see, this doesn't bring the fake intelligence into the party at all, does it? It excludes it, which you should, because there's no intelligence there. Why waste time with fake intelligence? Doing these exercises, all you have to do is try. And it's kind of like, let's say you've never sung before, and someone says, you need to try. I went through this, actually. I always thought I couldn't sing at all. I whisper in a voice like that. I always sang silently. I sang silently like that. I could sing really great silently. Really good silent singer. But singing out loud, no way. No way, no way, no way. Never did it. I was one of those people who, like, freeze up and wouldn't say anything. And one day it was suggested to me, why don't you sing? Why don't you try singing? I said, I can't. They say, well, what if your life depended on it? Could you sing? And I said, I don't think so. He said, why don't you try? And so I decided, finally, I was going to try. I got a tape of Elvis Presley's greatest hits. I put on the tape recorder, and cassette tape recorder, and turned it on. And I tried to sing, and I couldn't. And I started shaking and trembling, and I had like a nervous breakdown. It was like incredible. I just came completely unglued. And I was just in a panic. I was in an absolute panic, and I couldn't sing. I could not sing. And it shook me up so bad. And finally, after sweating and just trembling and shaking, my nerves were just going to pieces. I finally started singing, I was so terrified. And then I started singing. I said, huh? I hadn't heard that voice before. I sang a little more. So what's that? I didn't know I could sing like that. And then I sang some more. I didn't know I could sing. And gradually I kept singing and singing and singing and singing. And I realized, my gosh, I can sing. I totally shocked myself. I didn't even know I could sing. And then I went on to sing a lot, and then really enjoyed over the many years singing. But I don't know why I was resistant to it. Maybe it's not a good idea that I actually ever did sing. I don't know. I don't know who was asking me to sing necessarily. It could have been the ego trying to hook me into the entertainment world. Quite possible. And maybe my reluctance was I didn't want to get hooked into it. So I wanted to say, I can't sing at all. I can't sing. That's very possible. But the principle is that we don't know if we can do something until we actually try. We don't know we can do it until we actually try. The exercises can be done, but also you might feel like resistance, like I won't be able to succeed. I can't do it. That's the fake intelligence saying, you can't do it. Actually, it's saying it can't do it. And so you think that the fake intelligence is your intelligence, and it's saying it can't do it. So you say, better not try. That's crazy to even try. No, you have a true intelligence within you that can do it. It's the fake intelligence that can't do it. So you say, well, it doesn't matter, fake intelligence. I don't expect you to do it anyway. So why are you bothering me? I know you can't do it. I'm not asking you to do it. Nobody's asking you to do it. But the true intelligence saying, it's a piece of cake. Just say, this tree is not a tree. Just say that. Say, hey, this tree, not intellectually. You're not giving a reason why it's not a tree. That's academic intellectual stuff. No. You're asserting that it is not a tree. It's your assertion. You're asserting that you no longer want to perceive it as a tree. You're not giving any reason. Are there some process that turned it into not a tree, or how's it going to be? No, you're simply deciding, choosing that you no longer want to see that tree as a tree. That's the power of choice. You're asserting your power of choice. And how do you wake up to your power of choice? By beginning to assert your power of choice. Beginning to dream that you have the power to choose. All right. And eventually it'll generalize, and eventually you'll realize, hey, I choose to see the one life, and you'll see it. You'll see it. That's how it goes. That's how it's been explained to me, and I trust the explanation. I can see how it works. So I'm in the process of practicing. And doing pretty well at it. Not great yet, but pretty doggone well. Getting better all the time, dialing it in. And you can dial it in. You absolutely can dial it in. You can probably dial it in a week or two, and you'll see progress. As soon as you start actually doing it, you'll say, hey, I'm not so bad at this. I thought I'd be terrible. I'm not so terrible. I can do it, actually. I can say this tree is not a tree. I'm asserting it. This tree is not a tree. This tree has never been a tree. This tree will never be a tree. Those are assertions. You're choosing. You're saying, I will never choose to see that this tree was a tree. I will never choose to see that it will be a tree. I will never choose to see that it's a tree now. Instead, I choose to see beyond this tree the one life living, all forms, all things, just one life. Just one seamless life. That's what I'm choosing to see. Okay? It's an assertion. You're asserting it. So it's all assertion training. This is true assertiveness training. This is really true. It's a declaration of independence. In your own declaration of independence, true assertiveness training is to assert you that perception is your choice. Say, perception is my choice. My choice. Perception is my choice. And I choose to not see this tree as a tree. This tree is not 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 a tree. It's never been a tree, never will be a tree. This road I'm driving, this road is not a road. You're asserting that this road is not a road. It's never been a road, never will be a road. Assertion. Assertiveness training. And at some point you'll say, I will leave this planet. I'm going to sidestep the bullies so they can't find me. Because you don't want to confront them. Why? How does that benefit you at all? Doesn't. You might be able to tell them to take a hike, and they might get furious, and all this stuff could happen. But you just choose, hey, you know what? I don't even want to bother. Why bother with that? Doesn't help me, doesn't help them. So just assert, no. I choose to relocate. I choose to go to a better place right now. I choose to hang out in a really great place. And you'll just have the power of choice. You'll have the power of choice. You see, I choose to see the one life. And the one life is guiding me. I choose to be guided by the one life. I choose to exchange hypothetical scenarios. But we have to rehearse the power of choice. Have to rehearse it. And get used to actually doing it. So when we say, this tree is not a tree, you're getting used to asserting the power of choice. I no longer choose to see this as a tree. I'm going to see what's beyond this tree, the one life beyond this tree. Power of choice. That's what's coming. If there's any revival, that's what it's going to be. Okay, so you're being tipped off. I told you, I give you the information ahead of time. You're being tipped off. If there is any revival, it will be just this. There can't be any revival other than this. Power of choice. We must awaken to the power of choice. absolutely must awaken to the power of choice. And hopefully there will be some dynamic teachers who are able to help us, trainers, say, come on, encouragers, reassurers, encouragers, saying, come on, assert your power of choice, assert it, assert it, assert it, assert it. Not power over to force other people to do anything, not bullying anyone. It's changing your perception or choosing a new perception. Choosing a new perception. It's choice. So you say, no, I'm going to assert my right to choose a new perception. I want to assert, I am asserting my right to choose a new perception. I choose to see beyond all these, the many, the one. I'm choosing to see one life instead of many. That's your right to do so. It's your right to do so. Because all these lives in a dream, they're all fantasy lives anyway. Everything's here is a fantasy. So it's not like you're trying to change reality at all. It's not like the many lives are real. If you don't see them, you're somehow trying to deny reality. It's not that way at all. All these bodies, all these people, all these forms, these are simply the play of imagination. These are all hypothetical what-ifs. So we're completely within our rights to say, well, hypothetically, instead of what if there are many lives, what if I just saw one life? And that would remind us of reality, because reality, there is one, just one life. There is a complete wholeness, a oneness in reality. So perceiving a fantasy as just one life in all fantasy, just one life, solves the continuity problem, reminds us of reality. And this is the teaching that true intelligence has given me, so I'm able to share it with you, pass it on. And it required a lot of effort to be able to be fluent in this way. Fluent enough so I can talk, share this with people just spontaneously like this. I don't have any notes, no rehearsal. Just sit down and say, okay, boom, do it. All I have to do is speak from true intelligence. That's all. That's all. And it's easy for me at this point. It's easy. But I still can get better at it. Definitely can get better at it. Get better at the exercises too. So we're all working to assert our right to choose what we perceive. Okay? Choose what we perceive. Either the many or the one. That's the options we have. We have no other options. We either choose to see the many or the one. There's no, where is the in-between? Two, seeing two, that's still seeing the many. It's not seeing the one. So we either choose to see the many or the one. We choose to perceive the many or the one. Perceiving the many doesn't solve the continuity problem. Perceiving the one does solve the continuity problem. So we have to assert our right to say, and say, this is what we are going to do right now. This tree is not a tree. I'm saying this right now. I'm not saying it won't be a tree at some point. I'm saying right now it's not a tree. Right this instant. Even prior to this instant, even more immediate than this instant, this tree is not a tree. Doesn't even require an instant. It is not a tree. See that? That's the difference. It's not say, well, it's not a tree, meaning at some point it might not be. I don't want to say right now. No, right this immediate, even be sooner than immediate, is this tree is not a tree. This tree has never been a tree. That's also said right in the now. This tree has never been a tree. This tree will never be a tree. At no point in time, at no time will this tree ever be a tree. It's not a tree. You're asserting this tree is not a tree. And true intelligence gets this, says, ah, I see it. Your true intelligence will say, yeah, this is it. This is it. This is the training. And your fake intelligence, they'll say, this is nonsense. This is crazy. This guy's completely nuts. I don't want to watch the videos anymore. This is nuts. And the viewership's been dropping. As soon as I brought these exercises in, the viewership dropped in half. Dropped in half. Because fake intelligence says, wow, I'm not going to do that. That's nuts. That's nuts. It's not nuts. It's your salvation. It is your salvation. The power of choice is your salvation from dreams of death. Dreams of death. All we've been doing is trying to make death real and then survive it. Dreams of death. And we have every right to be safe from that. But we have the continuity problem, which is solved by perceiving one life through all fantasy forms, all fantasy. This is all just imagination. Through all imagination, just one life. I call it the overlay. One life. Just one life through all of it. Only one. Vision of oneness solves the continuity problem. So we are getting very close by doing these exercises. We're really getting going right into that power of choice, perception, choosing a new perception. And we have to do that. Seeing the one life is not a process. It's a choice. It's a choice. The two hypotheticals don't intersect. It's a choice. There's no process that brings it about. Rehearsal solves the continuity problem and is assertive, but the choice still has to be made. We still have to choose to perceive the one life through all. Okay, so stay with it. Stay with it. Don't drop out. The fake intelligence will drop out and try to take you with it. Say, no, I'm not asking you to do anything, fake intelligence, so don't worry. No problem. No problem at all. And then you just start doing it. Say, this tree is not a tree. Start with that. In your day, you're going to see a tree. And at some moment in your life, you're going to look at this tree and suddenly you say, wait, this tree is not a tree. Not academically, like classifying. No, you're asserting that you're no longer going to see it as a tree. See? So assert it. You say, hey, suddenly you'll feel assertive. Say, this tree is not a tree. During tomorrow, your next day, soon, when you see a tree, just say, this tree is not a tree. This tree is not a tree. And you have the power of perception. You have the power of perception. You can choose to see the one life instead of the life of a tree. Absolutely. Okay, very great. That's it. And so, remember that tree. Next time you see a tree, say, yeah. This tree is not a tree. And start it. Just start it. Very great. Let's stop this video now.